And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we shall desire. And he said unto them, What would you that I should do for you? And they said unto him, Grant us that we may sit one on thy right hand, and the other on thy left hand, in thy glory. But Jesus said unto them, You know not what you ask. Can you drink the cup that I drink of, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said unto him, We can. And Jesus said unto them, Ye shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of, and with the baptism that I am baptized withal shall ye be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared. And when the ten heard of it, they began to be much displeased with James and John. But Jesus called them to him and said unto them, You know that they which are counted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But so shall it not be among you, but whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister. And whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. For even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister, and to give his life a ransom for many. May the Lord Jesus bless me upon his word, may be sanctified in our heart. Just bow for prayer, shall we? Father, we're grateful and appreciative for this another occasion you've blessed us with to come together as the men and women and boys and girls of the Grace Bible Church. And we thank you, Lord, for this privilege that you have granted to us. And now, Holy Father, we pray that your anointing might fall fresh upon us one more time, to the end that we might see Jesus in his majesty, his splendor, his glory. We might see him beyond the sacred page. We might hear him speak to us a good word of encouragement, a good word of hope, and help and healing. Word of revival, a word of peace while troubled mind, and a good word of salvation to the man or woman, boy or girl that's never come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Speak, Father. Speak with clarion clarity. Speak, Father, with only the specificity with which you can speak. Yeah. To the end that every ear will hear what thus saith the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to borrow from a very popular cliche. Be careful what you ask for. Be careful what you ask for. Well, you might just get it. Be careful what you ask for. You may just get it. I wonder if we give much thought to our prayers. I wonder if we give much thought to our prayers. If we think about what we are going to pray about, and if we think about what we have prayed about after we have prayed, or do we just haphazardly go into the presence of the Lord with our latest wants and needs lists, just begin to spit out things that we want God to do for us and, oh, by the way, Lord, save the world while you're at it? Or do we really think about what it is that we're going to approach God with? I'm sure if we had an audience with the leader of the free world, we'd probably give some consideration before we met with him. And we would probably delineate and think about what we want to talk with him about, and what matters we would like to bring to his attention, that he might pass some policy or enact some piece of legislation or allocate some resources to address a specific issue or need that we thought was important. If we had the opportunity to speak with someone that is influential, we would give thought to what we would ask for. But I wonder sometimes in our prayers if we give thought to what we're asking God for. were amazed first, and as they followed, they were afraid. So we see this kaleidoscope of emotion they have. They're on their way to Jerusalem. And the text says they were amazed, number one, and they were afraid, number two. So why were they amazed and why were they afraid? Well, you Bible scholars know why they were amazed and afraid, because the last time they had been to Jerusalem, people tried to kill Jesus. And they knew that there was a possible contract out on his head, and the last place that he was welcomed at was Jerusalem. And so when the text says they were amazed that he would be leading them back to Jerusalem of all places. They were amazed that he himself would put himself in a situation to where, once again, he would be exposed to the hostility of his enemies. That amazed them. And then the text says they were afraid. With fear and trepidation, they were following Jesus back to Jerusalem, wondering if they would ever leave the holy city. They were amazed and they were afraid, but they were still following. That's a good word, isn't it? We sometimes criticize them, we malign them. We say a lot of things about them because we see the humanity of the apostles in particular. And the reason their humanity is so profound is because their humanity is exposed because it's laid down beside the Lord Jesus. If we were to read the Bible, if we would take out all the references to Jesus, then we would probably not think as negatively about the apostles as we do. But the reason that they look so ridiculous is because their lives are laid down beside the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. They really were some amazing men. Amazing women who followed the Lord Jesus during his earthly ministry. Because here, knowing that there was hostility in Jerusalem, knowing that there were people who wanted to take Jesus' life, knowing that there were people who wanted to take their lives, this text takes place just a couple of weeks after Lazarus had been raised from the dead. And the resurrection of Lazarus from the dead probably was the miracle that kind of put the religious leaders over to the side. Jesus must go. If he's going to go around raising people from the dead to leave testimonies behind about his power, we must silence him quickly. And so even though they knew that their lives were in danger, they still followed. Even though they knew that there was a contract out for him, they were still with him. That is a good word. Even when we are amazed at what he calls us to do, even when we are afraid as we're doing it, he calls us to be obedient. If we are obedient, he'll bless us. They were amazed and they were afraid, but they continued to follow. Verse 23. And Jesus speaks to the 12. Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be delivered unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death and shall deliver him to the Gentiles, and they shall mock him and shall scourge him and shall spit upon him and shall kill him, and the third day he shall rise again. I'm always amazed at Jesus' brutal honesty to the disciples. He never tried to sugarcoat it down what it meant to be a disciple. He never tried to mitigate the danger or the peril that they would find themselves in because they followed him. And now, here, with brutal honesty, he says, we're on our way to Jerusalem, and here's what's going to happen. And he gives it to them in graphic detail. We're going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be betrayed, delivered to the chief priests and the scribes. They're going to condemn me to death. They should deliver me over to the Gentiles. They're going to mock me and spit upon me. They're going to scourge me. And I'm going to be killed. But on the third day, I shall rise again. Brutal honesty. But there's something about the human psyche. There are times that we only hear what we want to hear. And we only believe what we want to believe. And so there are sometimes the times that when we live in a state of partial denial, not wanting to really face the reality of the situation or the consequence in which we find ourselves. And that was crucifixion, his burial, and resurrection, the two sons of thunder, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, they come to Jesus saying to the Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatever we shall desire. They're just like little kids. When my kids were younger, they would come to me with these type of requests. Now, Daddy, here's what, Daddy, you got to say yes. You have to say yes, and so they're trying to bind you to your word. They're trying to get a commitment from you before you know what it is they want you to say yes to. Make a promise that you'll keep your promise, that you're going to say yes to this. That's what John, James, and John are. They come to the Lord, and they say, Lord, that we want you to do for us, what if we actually do for us? Make a commitment that you'll honor our request before you know what the request is. Now, Jesus wasn't going to fall for that. And so Jesus, their request to him was, do for us what it is we want you to do for us without knowing what it is we want you to do for us. Then Jesus responds to their request in verse 36, well, what do they want me to do? What would you that I should do for you? And they said unto him, grant us that we may sit one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory. So here is their request. The request, first of all, is insensitive. It's an insensitive request based on what Jesus has told them is getting ready to happen to him. They offer no word of consolation, no word of comfort, no consideration of the fact that he's just told them he's going to be crucified. It's an insensitive request. And there are times to our request of God, our insensitive request. They are insensitive to the will of God, to the ways of God, and to the program and to the agenda of God. And so we push ourselves into the presence of God, and as if we're going to bind God to a commitment, Lord, you promised that you would do anything we ask if we just ask in your name. How much have we abused that? So you got to do what we ask you to do because you say you'd do anything we ask in your name. Insensitive to the will of God, to the word of God, to the ways of God, to the program of God. We're no different from the apostles. We are, at times, our requests of God are insensitive. Amen. Secondly, it is an ambitious request. An insensitive, ambitious request. The request is, we don't know, we don't care what the qualifications are, we don't care what the credentialing requires, we just want what we want, and we want to be the big dogs in the kingdom. We want to sit on your right hand, and we want to sit on your left hand, and I'm sure if had Jesus granted the request, James and John themselves would have been squabbling over who was going to get on the left and the right. Because the right hand, it was really the hand of honor. See, if it was the right hand side, it was the side that was given to the firstborn, or the honored son, or the honored person, so they probably would have argued over who would get the right and the left. But they had at least agreed among themselves that we got to make our move before the other 10 apostles make theirs. So the request is insensitive. The request is ambitious. The request is indifferent to God's will. But look at the response. Verse 37, still the request. They said to him, grant us that we may sit one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory. But Jesus said unto them, you know not what you ask. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? Let's stop right there. This is his response. He said, you really don't know what you asked for. You really haven't given any thought, any consideration to your request, to your petition. You are asking for a place of honor. You ask to be on my right and my left hand. What you don't understand is what it takes to get there. Be careful what you ask God for because you don't know what it's going to take for God to get you to where you think you want to go. And so there are some people who think they want positions of influence. They want positions of leadership. There are some people who believe they want positions of stature because it looks glamorous. It looks inviting. It's very advertising. They think that's what they want, and so they pray, Lord, increase my boundaries. Lord, they pray the prayer of Jabez. Lord, increase my boundaries. Increase my sphere of influence. But what they don't understand, that what the request prerequisites that are required for God to get you from where you are to where you go, where you think you want to go. And you may not really want to pay a price to go through what God is going to take you through to get you to where you think you want to go. Be careful what you ask for, because you might get it. So their request, though it was insistent, ambitious, and indifferent, Jesus' response to them was enlightening, and it was instructive. He gives them an instructive response because he does not take our requests lightly. He takes them seriously. Now, there are times when we as parents, our children, they might come to us and they might make requests of us, and there are some things that we just don't take serious. We just totally ignore. But when we make a request of God, God takes every request that we make of him seriously. And he will give us instruction and enlightenment around the request that we make. And so he gives them some enlightenment. He gives them some instruction here in this text. He says, now, are you prepared to drink of the cup that I'm getting ready to drink? Are you prepared to be baptized with the baptism that I'm going to be baptized in? And they foolishly said, we can. We can. Without asking for any more information, Lord, what type of cup are you getting ready to drink from? What are you, see, children would drink anything after anybody. I told y'all the story. True story, not a story. That's true. I was like them. I was like, yeah, I'm still like that now. I haven't been broken yet. And my Bethany always tells me she's going to set a booby trap for me. You know, they leave their soft drinks, their Gatorade, they leave their soda pop in the refrigerator, and so I just think it's, you know, community property. And my best and dad, you always drink it out for people. You better stop that. You better stop that. One day somebody's going to put something down, going to take you out. I've never learned my lesson yet. When I was a kid, you know, back in the country, people would paint, and most of your paint back then was not this water-based paint. Back then, you had this serious paint. And you had to get gasoline to clean the paint brushes and stuff and keep get the paint off of it. And I think I was about 3. I can barely remember. I was about 3 years old, I believe. And they've been painting around the place there, and they had this gasoline. It was in a 7-Up bottle. And the 7-Up bottle was sitting there on the porch, and here I come. I mean, 7-Up, it's always been my drink. I've always been an uncola man. And so I come and I take the 7-Up bottle and I turn it up. I mean, I turn the bottle up as best I can remember. And I almost died, literally, almost died. They rushed me to the hospital and the doctors told my mother it was a miracle I didn't die. And my throat was stuffed and messed up and so forth. But by the grace of God, I survived. But I still haven't learned my lesson. You would think that I would not drink after anything, that I did not break the seal off of myself. There are some lessons you just don't learn. You ought to learn. I should have learned, but I still haven't learned that lesson. So you would think that anytime I saw anything that I didn't break the seal on myself, I'd say, what is this? And who bought this? And where did it come from? And what is the contents? And how many hands are tested? But I don't. I'm just like the apostles. Just like the disciples. They didn't say nothing about, Lord, what type of cup are you going to drink from? And exactly what type of baptism are you going to have? They just assumed they knew what he was talking about. You know what they said about assumptions, don't you? They just assumed. They assumed they knew about drinking. They had just observed on many occasions the Passover, and they passed cups. So they were used to drinking cups. And they had experienced, watched John baptizing, so they knew something about baptism. So they just assumed that the cup that he was thinking about was similar to the Passover cup, and the baptism was similar to the baptism of John's baptism. So they said, sure, we can drink the cup and haven't killed us yet, and sure, we can withstand a little baptism in water. That's not what he was talking about. Jesus was talking about drinking from the dregs of the cup of his Gethsemane experience, where he would be wrestling with the enemy himself for his very life, drinking from the cup of betrayal, drinking from the bitter cup of rejection by people that are close to you. You've invested your life into, you give your very best to individuals, and those are the people that would turn their back on you. That's the cup he was talking about drinking from. And he was talking about a baptism into And you're going to be baptized the baptism that I'm baptized with. And this was a promise to them that they would endure suffering for their identification with him as their Messiah. It was a promise. That they would drink from the cup that he would have to drink from. They would be baptized with the baptism that he would be baptized with. And if you read Fox's Book of Martyrs, if you read Josephus, they document that all of the apostles, with the exception of John, died martyr's death. And John, they tried to kill John, they just couldn't kill him. John was boiled in a pot of oil and feather, badly burned and disfigured and exiled to the isle called Patmos. And there on the island of Patmos, John, this old saved apostle who had walked with the Lord Jesus Christ, whose body had been burned and disfigured, and there he wrote the Revelation. And probably 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. And there's some Bible scholars that say they just believe that maybe John was on the exile of Patmos. And he was there beside the water banks. He was looking in the water. And there in the water he could see himself, an aged old man, face disfigured and distorted, almost like a monstrosity. And there John wrote these words, "Beloved, now we're the sons of God. But it doth not yet appear what we shall be," John wrote. "I know what I am. I'm old. I'm broken down. My face has been marred and scarred and disfigured. I look like a monstrosity. But it doesn't yet appear what I shall be. For when he appears, I'm going to be like him. For I'm going to see him in all of his majesty and all of his splendor and all of his glory." This same John. This is one of those Johns that wanted to be on the right or the left hand. The same John who said, "Lord, I can drink from the cup that you drink from. I can be baptized with the baptism you can be baptized, you're going to be baptized with." And John did drink from the cup, and he was baptized in the baptism. And when he came out the other side, his faith was found to be real and genuine and bona fide. He didn't know that he was agreeing that he would have to go through all of that. He didn't know that he was acknowledging that he could go through all of that, because he didn't even know what it was that he would have to go through. But when he was tried, his faith was found to be true. And so in responding to their requests, Jesus gives them enlightenment. And he gives them instruction. And then in verse 40 he says, "For the sin on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it's to be given to them for whom it is prepared." Verse 41. "And when the ten heard it," they were as insensitive as John, they were as ambitious as James and John, they were as indifferent to Christ as James and John. They just feel that James and John had just won up. They beat them to the punch. They'd gotten their request in, James and John, the two sons of thunder, because their mother was also close to Jesus. They felt like that they had an unfair advantage. And so then they were indignant toward James and John because they thought that Jesus had made a promise to James and John that he hadn't made to them. And when the ten heard it, they began to be much displeased. Let's stop right there. There are times when we get upset and bent out of shape because it looks like God has blessed somebody else more than he blessed us. And it looks like God has blessed somebody who's not living as good as we think we're living. So we just, why they get that? Or why did that work out for them? And I pray and I tithe and I go to church and I share my faith and I'm really trying to live for the Lord, and they halfway show up and they're halfway committed. It appears that they were being blessed. It appears that James and John had gotten some privilege that they had not gotten. But what they didn't understand, all James and John had gotten was a promise from Jesus that they were going to go through persecution. That's all they got. All they had was a personal conversation with Jesus, and the only benefit that came out of it, if you were going to drink from the cup of loneliness, of disappointment, from despair, from rejection, from heartache, from brokenness, you're going to drink from that cup and you're going to be baptized in a serious baptism. They thought that they had gotten something that they hadn't gotten. So their indignation and their displeasure was all for nothing. But Jesus always is teaching. Class is always in session. So now he responds to the ten. He responds to the two's request, and now he responds to the ten, even though they did not make the request. up Gentiles to a Jew. I mean, he compares the Jews, these devout Jews who have been raised in Jewish home, been to the synagogue, had observed the Sabbath, had observed all the feasts, and the last thing that a Jew wanted was to be compared to a low-down, good-for-nothing Gentile. And Jesus says, you know, the Gentile, and when he just brought the word Gentile up, they started to cringe. Oh, my goodness. He's going to say that we're no better than the Gentile dogs. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan, right? In the story of the Good Samaritan, Jesus is actually talking to religious leaders, to quote-unquote spiritual people. And so the whole issue was, well, what is the greatest of all the commandments? To love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. And then to illustrate it, Jesus told the story of the Good Samaritan. And in the story, he has a Levite, he has a priest, he has the most devout Jewish leaders in the community, religious folk. And a man going down the Jericho Road, he's accosted. He's robbed. He's assaulted. He's stripped naked. He's left there bleeding and unconscious. And the Levite comes down and he sees the man, and the Levite crosses the street and goes on the church. And the priest comes down and he sees the man, and the priest crosses the street and he goes on so he can go to church. And then Jesus said a Samaritan came there, and that was worse than comparing a Jew to a Gentile, to compare them to a Samaritan, to tell a story about a Levite and about a priest and about the Jewish aristocracy and include a Samaritan in the story was an insult to him. And then to have the audacity to say that the Samaritan came down, got off his beast of burden, put some oil on the man's wound, cleaned the man up, wrapped the man up in his coat, took the man to the inn, told the innkeeper, here, I found this stranger on the roadside, bruised and battered, man had them all here, take care of him, and here's a piece of money, take care of all his needs, and if he has any more expenses, when I come back, I will sell with him. Amen. He broke them down. And then Jesus said to them, he said, which one loved his neighbor? And you read the text, they couldn't even say it. They could not even say the Samaritan. They could not bring themselves to say that a Samaritan was more spiritual than a Jew. That a Samaritan is more like God than a Jew. And so they said, the one that showed mercy. They couldn't say it. They said, the one that showed mercy. The one that they had to acknowledge it because the truth was evident, but they couldn't admit that a half-breed, low-down, good-for-nothing Samaritan would be able to live out the truth of God when the devout Jews couldn't do it. So now Jesus is doing the same thing for the apostles. He said to the Gentiles. The Gentiles, you know how they are. They like to rule over each other. They exercise lordship over each other. And their great ones exercise authority upon them. And they like levels of authority, so that everybody can be an unauthorized supervisor. And he says, you guys are thinking like the Gentiles. You're thinking like the unsaved community. You want the Lord over people. James and John, why do you want the right hand and the left hand? So you can tell Peter and Matthew and Nathaniel, so you can tell them what to do. That's what you want it. So you can have authority over them. He said, your ambition is misguided, is misdirected. He says your prayer request is for the wrong motive. And so we come all the way back to the beginning. Do we think about what we pray about? Do we think about what we ask God about? And do we interrogate our own prayer request? And do we interrogate the motives that we're praying what we're praying? God does not want us praying selfish, self-centered prayers. It does not mean that we should not pray that God would meet our needs. It does not mean that we should not pray for ourselves and for our family, but God wants our motives to be pure as to why we pray for what we pray, what we request, what we request. Amen. So he says, guys, don't think like the Gentiles. Don't think like the unsaved community. I have a whole different way of doing things. Verse 43. But so shall it not be among you. But whoever will be great among you shall be your minister, shall be your servant. And whoever of you will be the chiefest shall be served of all. So in this response to the 10, he now goes from enlightenment and instruction to illumination. He now just pours light on the whole situation. He says, God, I want you to really kind of understand the spiritual economy of how things work in the kingdom. He says, if you really want to be great in the kingdom, it's when you recognize that you are what you are by the grace of God, and when you humble yourself under my mighty hand, and when you allow me to instruct you and to fill you with my Holy Spirit to turn you into a servant. Amen. I've shared this with you before. It bears repeating. I'll share with you again. My mentor, my friend, Pastor Frank Murphy, told me something once. He says, if you remember this in your ministry, you'll always have a place to minister. There'll always be a place for you to minister. He says, number one, people get tired of their leaders. He said, go to any civilization you want to go to and you'll find if in a democracy, they vote them out. In a dictatorship, they have a coup or they assassinate them. Some kind of way they get rid of them. What the formal government is, there's a system by which people get rid of their leaders. Or they have someone else to get rid of their leaders for. He said, but people never tire of the servants. He said, so when we understand that ministry is about service, we have spiritual job security. It may not be in the venue that we want it to be in, but there will always be job security because people never get tired of faithful servants. Because at heart, everybody want to be served. Amen. Everybody want to be served. Amen. I tell y'all about my children. They growing up now. But I never forget, I should try to get them to help each other. Y'all ought to be loyal to each other. That's something that my mother instilled in me, my grandmother, that my brothers and my sisters, we ought to be loyal to each other. And I would tell my kids, you ought to be loyal to each other. You ought to help each other. And your brother actually do something, help him out. And your sister actually help him out. They would say to me, well, Daddy, slave days over. And I'm telling myself, what do you know about some slave days? What in the world do you know about some slave days you cater to? Your mama done changed and she nursed you and she birthed and she changed your clothes and she taking care of you. You've been served all your life since you came into this world. You've been served. And now you need to learn how to serve. What better place to learn how to serve than to serve those people you live in close proximity with? Learn how to serve them. If you do that, you learn how to serve them, you always have job security. Now it's amazing to me that we have went in this, in our society, we have gone from an agrarian society where everybody basically were farmers or in some way tied to the farm system, and then we move more into a industrial revolution, and then to a manufacturing economy, and to a high-tech economy, and then the economy is going all the way back to a service. Service. Who can provide service with a smile? Who can provide people with a service making people want to pay for it? You go to restaurants, who do you want to give the best tip to? The person who's provided you with what? The best service. Normally the food gets there, normally on the plate, normally it's edible. But the difference between whether you leave a good tip or a small tip or no tip is what is the quality of the service. When I was a younger man, I was not nearly as tactful as I am today. I remember I had my children down at one of our favorite places, Camden Park. You see, back in the day, it was easy to be a hero. All I had to do was take my kids to Camden Park. They didn't know about kings out of those places, so if you don't take them, they'll know about it, see? And so it was a major production. We would go down to, when it was small, we would go down to Camden Park almost every Saturday, a couple times a month after the soccer game. And I never forget, we went to this little stand, and one of my children ordered something, and it was a soft drink. That's what it was, a soft drink. And you know that sometimes the syrup gets low, and you got too much carbonated water, and not enough syrup, and so it tastes awful. And so I was always trying to teach my children to learn how to take care of business for yourself. So I'd go back and tell the lady, just explain to her, you bought this soft drink. Apparently there's something wrong with the system. It really doesn't taste right. So my little daughter, she went back and told me. Then the lady didn't know that I was standing off to the side where she couldn't see. not purposeful. I just happened to be standing off of the side out of her vision. And I heard her, she was talking to my daughter. Amen, Lord, if you'll take it, go on, take it. We're not going to take it back. You're drunk out of it now. So I just listened. Then I came back from around the door. I said, ma'am, I said, you're going to need to quit today. Right now. No, sir, you need to quit today. Right now. I said, because you're supposed to be serving people. You're supposed to be serving people. And I said, your attitude is so bad. That was, you need to quit. Just quit right now. Give the man your robe. Just give it to him. Right now, you couldn't be in this business. You're giving Kendall Park a bad name with your attitude. And I could have been a little more tactful, man, and probably should have. But she had offended my little girl. We go through the drive-thru. I don't do this stuff anymore. I done got nice now. We go through the drive-thru, ordering for Wendy's. You get your food. The McDonald's make the sloppy sandwich. They make the sloppy sandwich, ketchup all on the side, everywhere on the bun. I mean, what's this all about? It's not that difficult to do. I mean, the stuff is in a machine. They're not doing it by hand out of no bottle. All they got to do is take the thing, hold up, and hit the thing one time to catch the dropper. I did it. Stuff everywhere. So you go and you get your food, you have your french fries in the bag, cold, so forth. So I turned around and came back. And I said, look, man, I don't mean no harm, but I paid a full price. No discount. I didn't even have my normal supply of coupons. I paid the whole price. I want a whole thing of french fries, not three quarters. I want good service. Now, I've got to be more tactful these days. But you want to be served. We all want to be served. And if we tell the truth about it, we are the most offended, and we get the most upset when we feel like we have been disrespected when we have paid for something. When we're paid for it, we want to be served. So allow me to ride in the front of the bus when I done paid a full fare. You don't need me no favor. To allow me to go in the restaurant and sit down when I'm paying for the food, you're not doing me no favor. I'm paying for that. That's entitled. I'm entitled that because of the pay. Now, if you come back and make sure my water glass stays full, there's nothing. I don't buy no soft drinks like that. I'm not going to pay no $1.39 for it. I'm just not going to do it. I drink soft drinks at home. Water. With a lemonade to get no flavor. But if you keep a water glass clean, you keep moving the plates and getting the same, you're giving me service, now you're entitled to a little bit of extra 10 for the 10. An extra 15, sir. That's another story. Man, Christians will break this reputation. I was hearing Dr. Chuck Swindoll talking one time, and he was in going to the restaurant, and he happened to overhear it was Sunday afternoon, and he happened to overhear one of the waitresses saying, oh, Lord, I'm going to ask them to reassign me to another part of the plate. Because here come them Christians, they give some of the cheapest tips. And so we don't have a reputation. We don't want people running from us when we come. We want people to run the service when we come and give us good service. So what am I saying? We become indispensable in a society. We're indispensable in the kingdom of God. When we develop the attitude, we're going to find somebody to serve. And so as we close, Jesus says, if you want to be the chiefest, then serve. And then he put a capstone on in verse 45. For even the Son of Man. For even the Son of Man. He says, I'm not telling you to do anything that I don't do. For even the Son of Man, my whole reason for coming here was not to minister, to serve, to pour his life out in service. You see, when we understand that, it helps us to manage. It helps us to manage the disappointments of life. It helps us to manage the hurt and the pain of life, and it keeps us out of the valley of self-pity. Because if you're committed to serving folk, you will be taken advantage of. Who cares about a servant? Who's concerned about whether they hurt the servant's feelings? No, people don't consider themselves with the feelings of the servant. People consider themselves with their own wants and desires. But when you understand that we are mimicking and modeling the Lord Jesus Christ when we serve. So he says, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as ransom. Amen. To give his life as a payment. To offer his life as a sacrifice. And Jesus offered his life once and for all on the cross of Calvary. Amen. And so that we could be saved. Well, we would have forgiveness, access to the tree of life. And so that we can enter into God's program and we can be the continuation of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ here on the earth. Amen. You know, I get a lot of people coming to see me at different times. I got an incredible visit from a man this past week. And he's been involved in prison ministries all over the country. And he wanted to come just to talk with me and find out more about our jail ministry and our philosophy ministry and so forth and so forth. But he told me a story that was really, it was incredible. He says he was in Texas. And in Texas, doing prison ministry, Texas executes more people than the other state. And so he wanted to work with the inmates Deacon Mitchell on death row. He says in one section of this Texas state penitentiary, there were 60 men. This is one penitentiary, this is one section. There were 60 men that were on death row. And so he made a petition to go in and talk to these men. And to his surprise, they didn't want to see him. Didn't want to talk to him. And so he persisted that he could just get in and interview and talk to some of the guys. And finally they got a couple of the guys agreed to come in and talk to him. And he says, one of the first questions they asked him, I said, well, who are you with? And he says, I'm not with anybody. He says, I'm just a guy who loved the Lord Jesus Christ. And he says, I was an alcoholic and almost died from alcohol abuse. And God saved me by his grace. And I'm trying to tell people about the love of the Lord. They said, the reason we asked that question, he said, because we don't want our legacy to be that we was on some Christian people's video program. We don't want to be marketed and merchandised. He says that when the Christians come, it seems like they always got some hidden agenda. They're looking to write a book, they're looking to do a video, looking to do some type of commentary. And he says, we're getting ready to face death, and we don't want to have no time for that nonsense. And he said, the guy said, if you're really real, tell me something about eternity because I'm getting ready to go out into it. Amen. Tell me that I can find forgiveness. Tell me there's a God that can forgive a murderer. Tell me there's a God that will forgive a child abuser and a molester. Tell me there's a God that will forgive a rapist. I know I can get on the video. But I want to know, is there hope? Is there hope for me with this God that you Christians talk about? Is there any hope for me? Is there any hope? And he says he left that place really understanding how some of the things we do in the name of God actually turns people off from the gospel. And our unwillingness just to be the simple service of the Lord Jesus Christ. One beggar telling another beggar how we found bread. One person who realized one day they're on their way to hell, but somebody stopped them long enough to tell them about Jesus. If someone thought that life was worth enough, trying to persuade them to turn away from their wicked way and receive Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Amen. Even the Son of Man came not to be ministered to, but to minister and to give his life as a ransom for many. And so every day we're following Jesus, as we follow him with amazement. And sometimes our amazement that he would use us with all of our dysfunction, all of our craziness, all of our hang-ups, all of our limitations, and all of our problems. We're amazed he would use us in spite of all of that. Amen. Somebody told me about the Lord Jesus Christ. Yesterday I had a gentleman come to me and I had forgotten all about the conversation. Forgotten about the conversation. He came to me and he said, Reverend White, I really appreciate you. You're telling about this lady down here at RCCR that will help people maybe try to buy a home. He said, I really appreciate it. He said, we've been going. He said, she told us by September we're going to qualify. And we're going to be able to get a home. And I really appreciate you turning us on because we did never think, we never thought we'd be able to have a home. And he said, oh, by the way, I know I've been telling you I'm going to come to church. And he said, I know I haven't got there yet. But I just want you to know I can recite almost every sermon you preach on 98.7. Because I listen to you every Sunday morning, so I know what you're talking about. I haven't got there yet, but I'm listening to what you have to say. You never know the door that God will open for you to serve. You never know how he's going to open the door. You never know how you use to touch someone else's life. But be careful what you pray for. Because once you get a tiger by the tail, you can't let it go. If you pray that you want, if you pray to God, Lord, give me spiritual strength and give me, Lord, the valor and the courage so I can fight lions and tigers and bears. And once you get to fight the one, and once you have another tail, you can't let it go. You got to hold on. Amen. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, the servant of servants, who came not to serve, but to give his life as ransom. We thank you, Lord. And Lord, we thank you that sometime in our insensitivity and ambition and indifference, we make the quest of you. And we thank you, you are God of all knowledge and wisdom, that when you know how to answer some of our childish prayers. We thank you, Lord, you do respond to us with instruction, with enlightenment, and with insight. And you also give us great illumination that we might see the bigger picture of what you're doing and how you've called us to be part of what you're doing. Reach out to lost men and women, boys and girls who love the Christian service. They might see Jesus in us. And we thank you for that, Lord. So, Father, we pray that you give us the grace and give us the strength and give us the courage when we have to drink from the bitter cup. As repulsive as it might be, that we realize that drinking from the cup is sometimes required to conform us more to the likeness of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we have to be baptized with the baptism fire. Give us the courage and grace to trust you that you're going to bring us through. Father, I pray for those who have never come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that you might speak to them. Let them know, Lord, that you came to seek and to save those who are lost. Yes, Lord. You came to give your life as a ransom, as a payment, so that those who are captive could be set free. Move in a mighty way in Jesus' name. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. There's someone here this morning, you've never come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and maybe God has spoken to your heart. You sense a need, your desire to be saved, to be right with God, and to know that your sins are forgiven. If you're here, I just ask you to raise your hand right where you are. This is not for show. Someone will come and someone will pray with you and someone will share with you from the Word of God. Clear plan of salvation. That the wages, the payment for sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Someone will show you how you can be saved by asking Jesus Christ to come into your heart and to save you. If you're here this morning, I just ask you to raise your hand right where you are. Just lift your hand. And lifting your hand, you raise your hand toward heaven. draw close to the Lord. Renew your commitment to the Lord. Through prayer. We invite you to come to the altar. Let these men of God pray for you. Can we all stand together? God, our Father, we just bow before you. Thank you for those who come. And you know the reason they come. Some may have come, Lord, because of illness or ailment in their body. Others might have come because of a family situation, just a personal struggle. Others may have come just because their heart is heavy over a wavering child, a son or a daughter, a grandchild. You know, Lord, you know. And your word instructs that the broken spirit and contrite heart you will not despise. So, Lord, we're just praying that you would just speak. The men and the women who have come, speak, Lord. Church, amen.